I just love this book. And so I wasn't going to pass up a chance to come in to introduce Roger Rosenblatt, which I think I've introduced all three. This is your third novel, Roger, right? And I think I've introduced the two before. But I had the feeling after reading Thomas Murphy that I didn't know whether whether I'd be introducing Roger Rosenblatt or Thomas Murphy. So you'll have the same difficulty when you read the book. But I'm going to start with introducing Roger. Roger grew up in Gramercy Park. He went on to receive his degree at Harvard in Irish literature. And then he, in 1965, I can't believe it, 50 years ago, he was a Fulbright scholar for a year to Ireland. So he started in on his Irish venture very early in life. He came back to Harvard after his Fulbright and taught Irish drama and modern poetry at Harvard. And from there, he went on to become the literary editor of The New Republic. And later in his working life, he will become a columnist for Time magazine and The Washington Post. And his essays in Time won him two George Polk Awards. And for 23 years, he was an essayist for PBS's NewsHour, which was then the McNeil-Lehrer NewsHour and then the Lehrer NewsHour. But for his essays on that, he won both Peabody and Emmy Awards. In 2008, he was appointed a Distinguished Professor of English and Writing at Stony Brook University, where he remains. And teaching writing. And I think that he has well established himself now as well versed as the author of 18 books and 5 off-Broadway plays. In a recent interview in the New York Times, Roger says that his favorite genre is to read poetry. And his favorite poets are J.M. Singh, William Butler Yeats, and Paul Muldoon. But the last great book, he says, that he read is by another Irishman, E.R. Dodds, called The Greeks and the Irrational. It's about Dionysus, the Greek god of joy and freedom, who, he says, leaves you asking with as much fascination as fear, how much of life is a dream? Which leads me to introduce Thomas Murphy, the narrator of Roger's new book, who also reads E.R. Dodds, The Greeks and the Irrational. Thomas James Murphy is a celebrated poet who was born on the Irish Aran Island of Inishman. Murphy is also he tends to write simple poems with rocks in them. He is also a genius, a card sharp, a pop singer, a piano bar player, a raconteur, a bon vivant, and this is what gave me the clue that the narrator might be Roger. He's devilishly handsome. The Washington Post reviewed the author, saying Rosenblatt has created a memorable character with a magnetic personality. There is wondrous fluidity to his prose. And the New York Times said Rosenblatt's accomplishment is to draw the reader so completely into Murphy's mind and heart and memory that within the first few pages, we are all ears for Murph's stories and memories. So here's Roger to tell us about, we don't know whose memories, but he's going to tell us. Thank you, Roger.
Always a wonderful thing to be at Politics and Prose, and especially to see Barbara again. In that same interview, they asked me by what book was I most recently moved, assuming that I had the capability of being moved, which was very nice. And that was Alice McDermott's Someone. And since she is someone sitting over there, after you buy Thomas Murphy, by all means, buy Someone, which is a astonishingly wonderful novel by a novelist who is thrilling to read for other writers as well as readers. So you know about Thomas Murphy. He was born on Inishman. His wife, Una, died a year before the novel begins. So did his best friend, Greenberg, who was gay and who was everything. He was terrific. And so Murphy asked, what was there not to hate about Greenberg? He did everything right and was cruelly murdered. So he finds himself without his wife, without his best friend, but with Maura, his daughter, and with William, his grandson. So he loves his grandson just as I love mine. And the and because James is with us today, that you will be getting the G rather than the R rating reading of this book, but you may guess some of the things that Murph said. We meet him at age 73, wondering, what are you doing the rest of your life? The song by Alan and Marilyn Bergman, thank you. And my name is, and the, what are you doing the rest of your life, which he sings at the drop of a hat, sometimes in his skivvies in the courtyard of his building. You may be wondering what somebody named Rosenblatt is doing writing about Ireland. You may not. You can wonder about what you please, but this occurred, as Barbara suggested, when I was at Harvard and meandered really into a seminar taught by John Kelleher, who knew all things. He was so schooled in, he was Irish himself. He grew up in an Irish-speaking community in Massachusetts, in Lowell, Mass. And he never got an advanced degree and knew more about Ireland than anybody who ever lived. As a matter of fact, we who were students were very careful to watch him as he crossed streets and things like that, because if he went, there went an entire subject. He was confounded by a stammer, and so he drove students away who were not patient enough to wait. I really didn't have a choice. I had to take this particular seminar, so I was more than happy to wait. And when you waited on Kelleher and just waited for the sentence to come out, you got the goods. He was wonderful, and eventually didn't hear the stammer at all. So we went to Ireland, Jenny and I, in the mid-60s, as Barbara said. It was a wonderful year. Absolutely a wonderful year, made centrally wonderful when Barbara recalls quite correctly that it was 50 years ago, but our nearly 50-year-old son who was there, my brilliant, wonderful son who was conceived in Ireland. You may think this is sort of a family gathering to which you've just sort of meandered on. We've got Alice here and my son, my grandson. The rest of you who are not related will not regret it. The Irish are a wonderful people, and they're tough, and it's very important to be tough given the history. Also extremely kind, extremely polite, extremely generous, and wonderful for on strangers as we were. The only difficulty that we had in Ireland was with my name, the confounding name Rosenblatt. Actually, I've had some difficulty with the name, but the Irish had a special difficulty with it. So the postman, not wanting to be impolite, would always say, "Ah, good morning, Mr. Rosenblatt." Ginny and I went to a book auction in St. Stephen's Green, and in this vast 19th century hall, and we hardly had any money, but there was one collection of books that I wanted to bid on that had Flann O'Brien's That Swim Two Birds. And so we bid in this vast hall, three times the length of the bookstore, that you can hear the echoing. And we won. And so the auctioneer at the far end of the hall said, "Name, please." And I said, "Rosenblatt." A terrible silence followed this. "Name, please." You know, as if I'd said horse or something, that wasn't even to be considered a name. "Rosenblatt," I said. Again, the silence. "Could we have it one more time?" he said. Rosenblatt. I said, getting aggressive and hearing my name kind of roll into the diaspora and the horse thieves who were my relatives. And then there was a silence and nothing else. So we went through the auction. We went up to the front of the room at the end of the auction, and there was our package of books with the name written on top of it, Frozenwem, which we have kept to this day. We went out to, Ginny was now considerably pregnant with Carl, so I went on my own to Connemara, lived there for a little while, not too long, but picked up a little Irish, and looked across Galway Bay to Inishmon. I never went out to the Aran Islands then. But 3 years ago, we went back, and then when I was at Inishmon, Thomas Murphy, that is the novel, started to come into my mind. Not so much as a character first, but as a condition of life. These late years, which blessedly we have a lot more of these days. So what are you doing the rest of your life becomes a useful question for a lot of people. So the novel started to come to mind. And then when I started to write about Murph, about Thomas Murphy, and see what life I could create for him, poetry naturally came to mind. But I found myself channeling, and I never even used the word, much less felt the idea, Frank McCourt. Frank McCourt and I were friends, and he taught in our program at Stony Brook. He was the star of the program, and just wonderful to students, wonderful to fellow faculty. We would go out singing and drinking at night. It was great. I miss him enormously. And I did a couple of readings with Frank once. That was an experience. Yeah, the 500 people would show up. Four of those people were there to see me. Two were not related. And I would always go first because they were there to see Frank, and it was really like opening for the Pope. You know, they say, "Fine, that's very good. Now get off." And Frank couldn't have been more generous, wonderful, and smart. And I heard his voice coming through Thomas Murphy as I wrote. So it helped a bit because I knew how he would respond to certain situations and what he would say in certain situations. And so, even though he's gone, he helped the book. So I'll read you a few sections. I write these books in sections that move from one to another. I try to make it like music. There are no chapter demarcations in any of the last 8 books that I've written. And then we'll talk. One of the sections, James, will be about Thomas Murphy and his grandson. So I'll be sure to let you know that that's coming when that comes. Have I told you about this? He uses this question throughout the novel because it works both ways. He says, "Have I told you about this?" as if this were a casual thing, but actually sometimes he doesn't remember whether he's told you about this. "Have I told you about this? The day they dropped the giant turf?" It never happened, of course, but it was something. The sky was packed with balloonish clouds as dark as the turf itself. When we looked up, turf and sky were seamless, and it appeared that everything hanging over us, the entire universe, in fact, was turf. Only when the planes flew at a lower altitude of a few hundred feet could we distinguish the substance from the sky whence it descended. Even Mickey Kelleher, who never was impressed by anything, including the great Houdini, had to admit it was worth looking at. The great brown, grassy mass in the shape of a humongous brick, at least 3.5 miles long and nearly as wide, suspended over the island and held in place by 4 hovering World War II B-24 Liberator bombers. The noise from the engines was dreadful. Thick wire cables extended from each of the huge planes to a sort of hammock on which the turf rested. At the scheduled moment, the planes would release the 4 cables and the vast turf brick would drop on Inishmon like a fallen star. It was a gift from Dublin, we were told, or was it Brazil? Sean Cafferty thought Korea, but Cafferty was always thinking that Korea and Aaron had a mystical relationship. Whatever its provenance, the turf was supposed to have represented a generous gesture from the outside world to our people, a 1-year supply of the most important things in our lives. And it was true, at least from the viewpoint of us kids. The turf was the only thing the grown-ups ever talked about. when they weren't talking about dogs, pigs, horses, cows, and the size of Jocko Flaherty's head. And even when they were on other topics, turf always seeped into the conversation, so naturally everyone was excited as hell to look up at the big suspended beauty. The trouble was that the immense size of the thing, as long and as wide as the island itself, made it impossible to find a place to stand where the turf would not drop straight on you. So the entire population of the island, all 160 of us, including many of the dogs, pigs, horses, and cows, waded out to Galway Bay to the north and into the Atlantic to the west to watch for the big moment. Donkeys brayed, babies murmured in their mother's arms. As it happened, however, the turf was even bigger than we had estimated when it finally dropped, as if from a massive celestial trapdoor. Everyone on Inishmon, and I mean every living thing, peoples, dogs, pigs, horses, and cows, were covered in the stuff. Turf filled our mouths, nostrils, ears, asses, and all the slots, holes, and openings of every man, woman, and beast. This took some getting used to, I don't mind telling you, but after a few minutes of standing there, stunned like pieces of sod ourselves, Casey Carey, I think it was, yelled, "Don't we smell good?" And the grown-ups looked around at one another and agreed, and instead of wailing and bemoaning the fact that everyone stank like, excuse me, James, shit, they carped the diem and sang and danced and laughed and made a goddamn festival of the moment, and no one took a bath for a week. Make that a year. I better not read this one. He loves his daughter, Maura, and I'll read another section on that shows that. He does talk about being rocks in poetry. It's much like the Irish people themselves in many ways. He says a poem should consist of two part rocks, one part daisy, which is my opinion anyway. If the rocks aren't in the poem, you won't be able to appreciate the daisy. And if you take out the rocks so that all that's left is daisy, well, that's all that's left. It's not so yellow anymore. It wilts. You want hard language to convey soft thought, because in the end, all poetry is about love, and no one wants love without a background. The kiss and the slap. Now he takes William for a walk. He shows up, says, I'm here to see my best friend. Maura says, he's ready for you. You're going on your walk. He says, it's not a walk we're going on, is it, William? Tell Mommy. It's an adventure, he says. Maura zips up his little jacket. Don't let him out of your sight, she says. I won't, I assure her. I was talking to William, she says. And then they go, Central Park, William. I swing my arm in an exuberant gesture. Isn't it grand? A spot of green within the black forest. He never has to understand what I'm talking about to know what I mean. His hand slips into mine as we cross Central Park West to begin our sojourn. William takes in everything, as if he were poring over an ancient text. His expression, when not laughing, is scholarly, monastic. Where should we go today, William? I ask him. To the land of the flying donkeys, he says, referring to the subject of our last get-together. Why do donkeys fly, Murph? Why do donkeys fly, William? Who said they didn't? I say they do, Murph. Donkeys fly. Oh, why didn't you say so? Why do donkeys fly? You might as well ask me why donkeys fly. He giggles. You're silly, Murph. I'm silly. You're silly. You're the silliest person I've known since Elephantus. Who is Elephantus, Murph? Who is Elephantus? You might as well ask me who is Elephantus. All right, I'll tell you. He was king of the elephants. Was he very big? That's just the thing, William. He was as small as you, and that's why the elephants made him their king. He was unusual. Is it good to be unusual, William? Sorry, is it good to be unusual, William asks me. We are making our way through the park. Yes, it's great to be unusual. You're unusual, Murph. You're the most unusual person I know. We approach the bronze statue of Balto, the Siberian husky. I point it out. Well, that's the most unusual person I know, William. That's not a person, Murph. That's a dog. That's a person, William. Wouldn't you say he's unusual? He roars. We sit on a bench. There follows the rapid gunfire of typical William questions. If zebra stripes are brown, why do they look black? When do caterpillars realize they want to become butterflies? Do horses know that they're racing? How many rabbits would it take to push over the Empire State Building? Are you going to die, Murph? I look concerned. He looks matter of fact. Are you going to die? Everything dies, William. But I plan to be around for at least another 100 years. He gives me a hug. We circle the reservoir, then walk to the carousel, shut down for the winter. He climbs up on a stationary horse. You've read a lot, haven't you, Murph? I have, and you will, too, when you get the knack of it. I mount the horse behind him. He's just learning to read now. He loves Harold and the Purple Crayon and hates all of Dr. Seuss, as do I. Who read to you when you were little, William? My dad. When you were little, Murph. My dad. Want to get ice cream? We head in that direction. What did he look like, your dad? Like me, only he had a nose as long as a fire hose, he laughs. You have a nose as long as an anteater's, he says. You have a nose as long as Elephantus, I say. In fact, it's so long it's dragging on the ground. You have a nose, Murph, as long as a fart. He screams with laughter at his own joke. Mommy would not approve of your saying fart, William. I keep a straight face. You just said it yourself, Murph. You always say it. Fart? Shocked and dismayed. Fart? Why, William, I've never said fart in my life. He gives a sly smile as we bounce along, arriving finally at the ice cream wagon. What flavor will it be, William? Chocolate? Fart, he says. They don't have that flavor, I tell him. He looks resigned. Chocolate then, Murph. He thanks me and takes the cone. We sit together on a bench. William, in my most severe, grown-up, authoritative voice, we must agree never to say fart again. He nods gravely until a moment passes and we shout in unison, poop. Inishman had a strange effect on Murph. On the one hand, it's the hard place in which he was born and of which his poetry was born. On the other hand, it was as poor as a place could be, as hard as a place could be, and he wanted out. This is not unusual in Ireland. You love for everything that it gives you, and you want out. Lots of people want out. So he tells the story. This is a ritual that I entirely made up, so don't look it up. In their trance, the grown-ups sat in concentric circles in a field, the men in the inner circle, the women in the outer. Have I told you about this? We children were excluded, but were permitted to watch. What good these ancient harvest rituals were supposed to accomplish confused me, since the only crop I ever saw in Inishman were potatoes and little enough of that. Studying the land like rocks. Still, the grown-ups prayed like their druid ancestors year after year. They were more successful when they asked divine powers for fish, the invisible crop that seduced men to the ocean where many died. Sing caught the repetitive sadness of the island fishermen in Riders to the Sea, the relentless scraping of the kuros on the bay, looking like the shells of mussels, but heavy. 4 big men at a time hauling the boats to a place on the shore where the vessels could float. The men would climb aboard and wobble out, slowly out and slowly back, if ever they came back. In their circle in the field, the men sat bobbing back and forth as if at sea themselves, like the davening of Jews of which I learned from Greenberg much later in America, bodies rocking, keening for the dead and for their lives. The women surrounding them did the same. They wore hats of red and brown wool, and their great arms glistened in the moonlight that beamed behind the ribs of the clouds. They prayed in Irish, the lilt of the rhythms lifting up and down in the human circles, rising and falling like boats. At the top of a hill, a thick gray horse half-heartedly grazed. Outside the two circles, we children played like sprites and ghostly figures. We dressed up as animals. I don't remember why. It wasn't part of the ritual. I'm pretty sure of that. Perhaps one child did it once long ago and the custom caught on. We dressed as goats and hares and sheep and unreal animals too, satyrs and unicorns, in a concocted mythology. The liquid shapes of us moving about the shadows and the moaning of our parents and grandparents. One year I was a boar, another a wolf. One time I was a ram. I snorted and spat like a ram. I spoke the language of rams. What all this looked like from above, I cannot imagine. The elders prayed under the sighs of the moon. I remember thinking, what sort of god would be moved by such a sight? What god would be impressed by the prayers of a people as small and miserable as my own? In the center of the circle of men, a turf fire burned in dull ashes. It neither flared nor tapered nor extinguished itself, but held to a steady warmth and its shifting colors of red and brown. After several hours, the gray smoke generated by the fire rose and settled on the people like a cloud descended. It filled our nose, eyes, our eyeballs. My senses were filled with smoke. The night I was a ram, I met a bull. Timmy Leary was the bull. His horns were alder branches. While the grown-ups prayed, we had it out head-to-head on the dead plain near an outcropping of chipped rocks. We stalked each other as the moon swirled around us. On a patch of frozen rainfall, I got him down, though Timmy was bigger, a wide table of a kid. Still, I gathered up my ramness, lowered my great round horns, and hit him hard in the stomach. He hit his head on a rock and was dazed. Lying on his back, he eventually opened his eye like an owl's, and I picked up a rock as if I were about to kill him. Timmy Leary, the sweet laughing boy who never did me a moment's harm. As we were walking back to the circles of grown-ups, he asked me why I did that. I told him it wouldn't be you I was killing, it would be them. Them, he said. But by then I had left him to go his own way, and I turned toward the cliff over the skull of the sea. Now he takes Maura to a birthday, which she doesn't want to celebrate because she's turning the incredibly old age of 40. And today is Maura's 40th birthday, too, which she hates my mentioning, thinking that at 40 she's over the hill. And we're together at Gunn's, a half-restaurant, half-bar, all-Irish dive where the customers sing their hearts out at the drop of a hat. I don't mean karaoke. That's too modern and easy for Gunn's. The folks who come here are as old as I am, or young people with old souls, and they know the words to all the songs they want to sing. The piano player at the chipped and scarred and tinny upright is Rory, a guy my age who, they say, was left in a basket at Gunn's and decided never to leave. Rory plays everything in the key of C. It's the only key he knows. Still, when anyone asks him to play this or that, he always asks, "What key?" The person says, "F sharp." Rory nods and plays it in C. "Rory," I called from our table. Maura cringes, attempting to disappear beneath her hands clasped over her head. "Do you know happy birthday to you?" I ask him. "I want to serenade my daughter." "Why," he says, "don't you like her?" "In B flat major minor," I say to him. "Maestro, if you please, right," shouts Maury, and I belt out happy birthday in the key of C quite beautifully, if I say so myself, and there's not a damp eye in the house. Everyone joins in, and blushing Maura is obliged to stand up and curtsy. "What a beauty," shouts Rory from the piano bench. "Am I not," I say, and the whole place boos. "What'd you get me for my birthday, Murph?" She puts on her little girl Christmas face. "I got you this necklace," I say, reaching into my pocket and displaying a string of antique pearls set in a purple velvet case. Her eyes widen. "They belong to your mother," I say. "They did," she says, then searches my expression. She always knows when I'm lying. "No, they didn't," she says. "Well," I say, "they belong to someone's mother." "Anyway, they're beautiful," she says. "Thank you, Murph." "I also wrote a poem for you." "Oh, read it, Murph. Don't mind if I do," I say. And I take out my little notepad. "Of all the fauna and the flora, no one's as lovely as my Maura." "Oh, Jesus," she says. "Lovely at 20, lovely at 30, lovely when she's talking dirty." "May I go home now?" she says. She pretends to reach for her coat. "Lovely at 35, lovely at 39, lovely drinking beer, ale, whiskey, and wine." She sticks her thumb down her throat as if trying to gag. "Lovely if you call her shorty." "Oh, no, you don't," she says. "Don't you dare. Lovely still at the ripe old age of..." She drops her napkin in my drink. "I don't know what you're complaining about. I tell her you're a spring chicken. It's me who's old." "You're telling me," she says. "Old, wicked, drooling." "I'm not drooling," I protest. And with all that, I say, "You have to admit that I'm the cutest 72-year-old you ever saw." "True," she says. "You're cute the way otters are cute. Cute face, mean spirit." "I wouldn't mind being an otter," I say. "Lie on your back all day, eating and dreaming. So different from your own life," says my ungrateful child. "Otter dreams," I say. "What do you suppose an otter dreams about?" Beside herring, says Maura. "Maybe learning to swim on its tummy." I brighten at her idea. "Let's write a children's book," I suggest. "The otter who learns the breaststroke. How would the book begin? She says. I lean over the table toward her. One day, I say in my best children's book tone, the sweetest, prettiest, smartest lady otter in all the world woke up, stretched in the sunlight, and exclaimed, "It's my birthday." Excuse me, James. "Shit, I'm 40. Maura has her Irish up now. "You are going to get it," she says, rising from her chair. "Time to tickle the world's oldest, meanest otter." She knows I can't stand to be tickled. I rise from my chair at once and move away from her around the table, Maura in hot pursuit. Still circling, I call to Rory, "Happy birthday one more time, me boy." "What key?" he asks. "Becky Sharp, flat Asia minor," I tell him. "You bet," says Rory, hitting a major chord in middle C. And once more, the entire joint bursts out singing "Happy birthday to you, to my beloved daughter," who stands in surrender with her arms at her sides and helplessly laughs. He misses Una a great deal, misses his wife a great deal, and so this little section goes to that. "What I miss most, Una, it's curious, I know, is the first time we met. Here's why. Because if I could have that moment back, I would savor you rather than savor you savoring me. You have no idea how lovely you looked that day, like a gesture linking intelligence, sex, and grace all bundled in you. A look capable of understanding and forgiveness on the large scale, not forgiveness for this transgression and that, but rather for the whole race, as if you were embracing all human ecstasy and error in your smiling eyes. When Greenberg introduced us, 'Una, here's Tom Murphy, he's a poet,' your look had interest in it, so naturally, vain cockhead that I am, I thought about myself. Was she impressed at meeting an honest-to-God poet? Did she like what she saw? I wondered only how you were judging me. If I could get that moment back, I'd cut me out of the picture and focus only on you. That's how I'd make best use of the time. I'd hear only your voice and behold only your smile and lose myself in the experience, the way Keats talks about dying into life. Lose myself and dream into you as I try to dream into life when I write. I would stop all the clocks around us too so that we might freeze our moment, freeze the shot the way they do in movies. The brown redness of your long hair, the firmness in your face, your shoulders, arms, would be there before me. I would lack for nothing. There were times over the long years when I'd catch the light, standing in the park or in the hallway, unaware that I was watching, and then you would see me and you would be embarrassed by my admiration and shoo me off with a wave. If I notice similar light these days, I picture you under it. That's but one of the things that brings you back to me. A little girl on a trike looks like Maura, a piano playing somewhere in the building, a crash of dishes on the day you cracked your hip, someone sings Come Rain or Come Shine or True Love, a tapping on a pipe. I hear your two-step. All connections are welcome to me and precious. My endometrial dancer. She died of endometrial cancer. But if I could have just one moment back, it would be that first meeting, which was like a word one puts in a poem, a noun probably, since nouns contain the power of things, a word you search for all your life. And who shows up bearing that word but the great Greenberg figures? The word, the one and only word, standing in front of me, extending her hand. He meets another woman. He never thought he would meet another woman. Or anyone who would touch his heart, but he meets a blind Sarah. Sarah is blind. He meets her under extraordinary circumstances, which I won't describe, but you might enjoy reading them. It's a freakish way he meets her. And she has been reading his poems, and they know each other, sensibility to sensibility, and she's very funny. And very good, and probably good for him. She writes him a letter. They write letters at the beginning. He gets a Braille reader so that he can read her letter. "Dear Murph, it occurs to me that you may be wondering why a glamorous exotic beauty such as myself would be wasting her glamorous exotic time with a possibly demented hoary fellow such as yourself. So here goes." And she starts to write him a letter for the reasons that she loves him, and then she comes to this. "When you're blind, you learn everything from something else. I know the location of my front door when my knuckles brush the top of a ladder-back chair in the kitchen. When I feel breadcrumbs underfoot or coffee grounds, I know it's time to sweep the floor. The dry leaves in a flower pot tell me to water the flowers. You may think, how limited her life. In fact, it's an arrangement of endless expansions. Every element betrays its position by relating to another element, and you know the world by these implications. So it is that I know the world through your touch. You take my hand when we walk, and you think you're protecting me. I appreciate the gesture, but the pleasure's all mine. I love touching you and you touching me, however grazingly. I love brushing against your shoulder, accidentally or not. You think I can't see where I'm going. I love when we sit side by side in a tight place and our knees touch, bone to bone. I love to grasp your elbow or laugh so hard that my head collides with your chest. I love the feel of your flat palm on the small of my back when you steer me from behind. If you had to reduce all the reasons for my attraction to you, Murph, it would be this non-reason, pure unreasoned touch. So this is what I think you wanted me. So this is what I think you wanted to know, dear Murph. You are my braille. And one, finally, let me read you, Murph, on the question of inspiration. It's very interesting. The other night I was at the Center for Fiction, and with Paul Muldoon stooped to talk to me about my book. And Paul was just wonderful and saw things that I never would have said. I always teach my writing students, if someone, if a superior tells you, congratulates you on something you did in your book, always say you meant it. But I really couldn't get away with it with Paul. Anyway, he asked me a question about inspiration and what Murph thinks about inspiration, what writers think about inspiration. And he pointed to a section of the book that I'd forgotten, but I'm going to read that to you now, and we'll wind up. As a poet, I have to believe in God, though I have little affection for the God I believe in, and he has none for me, none that he shows anyway. Yet I must believe, or I could not write words, structure, anything. The whole process of writing a poem is mystical, to me at least, mystical and beyond my reach. Have I told you about this? I begin a poem with an image out of nowhere. Where did that come from? And at once suspect I am part of a plan, and the poem I've begun is part of a plan. The process of writing, then, is the progression towards someone else's design. And who could that someone else be but God? It's why I think whenever a poet arrives at the end of his poem, the moment is always unsatisfactory, a letdown. Because you think, is this all he had in mind? But there you are, nonetheless, sweating like a pig and breathing hard, and knowing you've tried your hardest to fulfill what was decreed, preordained. And of course you failed. It's why I tend to write simple poems with rocks in them. I have throes of fanciness in me. I have to beat them down sometimes, but generally I dismiss them as fake thinking, as fiddling with knowledge or language for the silly sake of doing it. I know that dandyism does not make for real poetry, ars poetica. This comes from my dad, too. He could not stand waste of time or behavior or language. He'd tell me most talk is horseshit, but not as useful. He always spoke in a straightforward way, putting one word in a slot where a lesser man would have stuffed three. Thus, every word he said to me was beautiful. There's a connection between this simplicity and my feeling that a poem of mine has been written before I write it, that I am tracing the original drawing the way children trace. And in that same way, the tracing is different from the drawing beneath it, even if it follows the lines as carefully as the child is able. As a poet, there is always something uniquely yours in the traced work, something your own that even the original artist may not have divined. Like those copyists of the old masters who were compelled to leave a clue that they, mere copyists, existed too. And to reach that point in a poem, it is best to keep the language simple, like my dad's, and not to muck the thing up. What happens then, even though you know you have failed to follow the plan perfectly, is that you've done something worthwhile on your own imperfectly. You have kept it simple, but it is not simple. The poem has taken you to the edge of the sea, to the point where the vast sea is revealed. And though you know you cannot recreate the sea, for all its welts and fathoms, with its treasure ships half buried in the sand on the bottom, among the kelp, and its killing fish and its killing winds and manacles, still you have brought yourself to the brink of revelation on that shore, and the beginning of revelation is, for all intents and purposes, revelation. You never crash if you go full tilt. It takes a kind of courage to write a poem. My ma's and dad's courage, and Kate's courage, a friend of his, and Kate's courage, and Una's, when she was certain she was doomed, and Sarah's courage, too, when she was little and knew that she had to live all her coming days in the dark and yet get on with it. The courage to gun it, even though you're predetermined to fail, because between that certainty and the attempt to refute it is life, boyo. Dreadful, gorgeous life. Thank you.
Okay, we've got two mics here. One here for questions.
No math. A question, a comment?
There's somebody way back there, Roger.
Come.
I have a loud voice. I don't think it's going to be a problem.
Very good.
But some of the great ideas in fiction that I've read about the authors and where they got their ideas are anecdotal. And I was wondering, have you ever heard anybody refer to somebody's love as touch and braille as being what describes that person?
I have not, but I'll tell you that it is less impressive once you get into the character. I mean, we really are in the presence of a genius of fiction writing in Alice, who knows this better than I, a lot better than I. But once you get into a character, you start to think, what is the world in which this person operates? So I invented a blind woman, okay? Once I invented a blind woman, how then does she know where things are? Okay, so she says that. And then she wants to say something to Murph that will mean something to her and to him. And she can't see him, you know. Hearing him would be too easy and things like that. So she draws on the very thing by which she identifies her place in her room, in her house, in her world, in touch. So one thought follows another. If you get yourself, if you put yourself in the position of the character you have, how would she react? What would she know? What would she not know? And that's how it.
It's so beautiful.
Thanks.
We all touch each other in different ways, especially when we're loving something. Thank
you. You bet. Thank you very much. Yes?
I have a comment on a lighter note. I discovered you through the aging book. And I kept a copy. I've given dozens away.
You are my annuity. Well, I couldn't.
Rules for aging. Tell everybody the title.
Oh, it's Rules for Aging. And it's just, you know, it's not really, it's Rules for Living if you're getting older, but it's the same thing. But it's a sore point that you bring up. The sore point between my wife and me. The Rules for Aging was written over a tremendous amount of concentration and study in 6 weeks. In which I would come down to breakfast and I said, how about this rule? She said, fine. And then we would just go with the book, okay. Never expected it to go anywhere. Never expected it to do anything, of course. Certainly my editor, when she was talking to me, did not. And suddenly the thing became a bestseller, and it's the only it's the only thing I can count on during the year for a check. You know, so somebody comes in. So there's all that, and I did enjoy writing it, and I'm glad you enjoyed reading it. But of course, Ginny says, "Well, we made a bundle on that. How about Rules for Aging 2? Instead of Thomas Murphy or something that's serious." No, she didn't say that. But that there is a temptation always if something has a small success, and it was that, to capitalize on it. And I looked at it the other day, and it's not half bad. So I'm. And if you want to like buy that book, you'd do that too.
I recommend you.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Roger, you've got to
sir.
You know, why Muldoon? What? Just a brief burst on why you feel Muldoon so special among the poets.
Oh, Jesus.
And the effect maybe it's had on your own writing.
He floors me. First of all, the range of things that he does, rock lyrics, and the ways he plays his language. But you can get misled by Muldoon because he can be so funny and so playful in this. But you read some of the early poems when he goes at the British, these spreading of smallpox poem. I forget the name of the title, and he can be furious in a way that is so amazing. You know, not as I said in that interview, not since Yeats has a writer been able to write that beautifully and that angrily at the same time. So everything I've ever read about him, I was bowled over. I was just grateful that he wanted to talk to me about this book. Do you like him? Muldoon.
The little bit I've read, yes.
Yeah. No, you. I mean, it's a tremendous, and the range is tremendous. He's really good. Also, he's very funny. We were appearing at another place, and we were asked to have lunch with the donors. He said, "Organ." Any other thoughts, or? Yes, ma'am.
I think the review of your book referred to Murphy and his memory loss.
Yes.
Which didn't come through so much.
I forgot to talk about it. I'm sorry. That was too easy.
So I wondered if you wanted to add.
Yeah, no, you. Thank you. You're absolutely right. In fact, Maura and he are at odds right at the beginning of the book. She's trying to get him to see a neurologist. He, being he, fools around with the tests that are given him. So his where the hell is this? Oh, 93, 86, 79, 72, Dr. Spector is about to form an expression. 64, I say, to see if she will indicate alarm or mere clinical interest. Maura searches my eyes for mischief. She calls me Holden Caulfield without the maturity. The doctor says, "Remember, Mr. Murphy, we are counting down from 100 by sevens." "Oh, I forgot," I say. "In that case, 65. "Did you really forget, Mr. Murphy?" she says, "or are you just messing with me?" It's the first thing to come out of her all morning that makes me like her. "I forget," I say. She says, "You think this is all a joke, Mr. Murphy?" "Depends on what you mean by all," he says. So he plays with this, but he worries about it, too. And he worries about it in the novel when he's not in Maura's thrall or the doctor. And he could be losing his memory. And then he goes into some interesting things and saying, you know, there's a lot to be said for forgetfulness. And he takes that. He can't help it, you know. He has to think creatively or poetically, even about something that could be very serious and ruin his life and the life of those around him. And Maura is very serious about him seeing the doctor, having tests, and making sure his marbles are intact.
But you leave it ambiguous in the...
I do. No. Funny about ambiguity, by the way. There were other reviews, either Wall Street Journal or somebody. Anyway, Sarah's real. I promise you, she's real. Okay? But because I established, see, Alice must know how to do this. I don't. Because I established this guy as a dreamer, the reviewer said, "Who knows if Sarah's real?" And I thought, oh, Christ, you know, I can't even get that right. And then, of course, I got on my high horse and said, well, I'm just so clever that it's ambiguous. But I really didn't mean it. I meant that she is absolutely real. There are things that he does do a lot of dreaming in the book. It's natural for a writer, especially a poet, to dream. And so he does. There are accidental ambiguities in the book as well, evidently.
Okay, we got time for one more question.
Here's one.
Okay.
An example of learning to live with his regrets. Would you give us some examples?
Oh, I'll give you one that comes to mind immediately. In the middle of a long thing where he goes over he's walking in the street and he's thinking about the past. He says, "Why did I not write Snodgrass?" Has no meaning to most readers. William Snodgrass was a great poet in the era of Robert Lowell. As a matter of fact, he really was the first confessional poet, not Lowell. But Lowell wrote the great life studies. And so Lowell became the head of the movement and so forth, quite justifiably. But Snodgrass was a great, great poet. He, my Murph, published a poem in the Antioch Review. All this is made up. Snodgrass wrote him a complimentary letter. And he never wrote back. And he asks himself over and over, why did I not write Snodgrass? Was I overwhelmed by the letter? Was I such a snotty guy that I thought I was his equal and shouldn't write back? And it haunts him as a regret. It's a curious regret, but it falls into that category of regret which you and I have and everyone does have, of the small gesture you didn't make, not the one that you did, but the small gesture you didn't make, which was a cinch to make. All you had to do was nod in the right direction, say the right thing at the right time. It wouldn't take any energy at all, and you didn't do it. And so throughout the book, there is a time when he asks, why did I not write Snodgrass? So thanks.
Okay. Thank you.